and they carry me down to my dying ground. Don't you weep for me when my time has come and I must move on.
Touched on a really interesting point that when people hear about funerals and celebrations of life, they think that the picture I think most people get in their mind is of a group of people sitting around weeping. And I had a very similar experience to yours, that when my brothers and I got together for my dad's funeral with mom, it was in many ways a very happy occasion. First of all, we never all get together because we're spread all over the country. But also, the reminiscing and whatnot were happy things and fun things and really good moments. It was not, I don't think at any point were any of us sitting around weeping.
Exactly.
And particularly with someone who had a great sense of humor, you just don't want to do that. And I think it's fun to share some of the happy memories. And I learned things.
Stuff you never would have known.
No. And even my mom said that. She goes, I was married to this man for over 50 years, and I've learned more in the past 3 days about the man that I married than I did in 53 years. Yeah. And I said, well, there you go. And his friends from high school came to the funeral and whatnot. And it was a really positive experience for mom and for us.
Yeah. Well, I know when my father passed and my sister had been one of his main caregivers while he was in the nursing home. She would go in and do his laundry. She would go and feed him and spend time with him and stuff. And I lived here, so I never did that. And that would not have been my thing to do.
Yeah.
When he passed, of course, I looked after all those details, right, talking the family through it. But also I said, I will conduct the service. And my sister was, no, you can't. You won't be able to. And I went, I'll tell you what, just to put your mind at ease, I have a friend who lives here who's also a minister, and I'll put her on the back burner. So if anything happens and I can't do it, then she will do it. Because my sister couldn't even get up and say two words. So for her to imagine somebody standing up and doing an entire service on behalf of their parent, that was something she couldn't even comprehend.
Yeah.
But it was great. I mean, I had to tell a bad joke. Because my dad always did. His jokes, of course, were so off color, I couldn't possibly share them. I did a video montage, and in there, some of his Halloween costumes were in those pictures. And it was, throughout the whole thing, there was laughter, there was tears, there was a celebration of this man that, we'd spent so many years with. And it was a lovely experience. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to watch how different people process and what they're capable of.
Yeah.
And that's why we're all a little bit different. Some of us can be the caregiver in the nursing home or at home, and others can be the caregiver of the living people who remain once the person's gone.
Yeah.
And I think all of us getting okay with our role is probably a good thing too.
Well, I was wondering too, in upcoming years, one of the discussions that I have had with my family is we're all big believers in the right to die.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I actually remember writing a paper on that when I was in high school, and probably because I'd seen that friend of mine, well, she died very slowly at home with very little joy,
right?
And sort of knowing about the pain and suffering that this person's going through, and not being able to have a dignified and happy end. And those sound like contradictory terms of a happy end to life, but in so many ways I've just seen the medical profession prolong life so unnecessarily. And
we wouldn't do it for our dog.
No. Well, and my mom made a tongue-in-cheek comment about it. She goes, well, I want to be put down before I'm in that kind of shape.
Me too.
I have to say that I would agree, and I think that we should be allowed to make choices about the time and place that we leave the earth.
Absolutely.
And I sort of think, too, that if we have more control over that it's going to change not only the discussion, but how we feel about leaving. Because right now, I have to say, my trepidation you know, of any about the end of life is about that quality.
Absolutely.
And about how much the medical community is going to take from me and how much I'm going to be at their mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And not have choices about saying, hey, you know what, this is not how I want it to go. And I know my father, well, he was still, you know, a fairly sound mind. I mean, he was losing it, but still able to sort of realize what was happening. One of the comments he had made is, this is my worst nightmare. He was an academic and a biblical scholar. So for him, he couldn't read a book anymore. He couldn't do anything.
That would be hell.
He couldn't do any of the things he loved. And seeing himself lose his faculties was not only, it was the most horrifying thing he could have imagined.
Mm-hmm.
He knew that it was going down the path where he would be what he was at the end, and he was almost vegetative.
Yeah.
And sort of drooling in his chair.
Mm-hmm.
That is not what, how he wanted people to see him, ever.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, you know, that sort of legislation is, I think it's still got a long way to go.
Yeah. My dad wasn't even able to sit.
Wow.
Like, they would try to prop him up with pillows and stuff so he could at least sit for a little bit each day. But the Parkinson's had him completely, like, yeah. He was like a rag doll.
Yeah.
And it's like, what is the point of that?
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing, is it's, I don't see a point to, okay, well, we have a functioning organism with assistance. Well, you know, there's six tubes, pipes, and there's, you know, something doing this and doing that. So you're sort of half machine, half organism. I can't even call it human anymore because, you know, when you lose a certain amount of cognitive function and your sense of self.
Well, that's the big one, right? Is you sort of lose everything at that moment. And are you really there anyway anymore? Mm-hmm. Or is there just this shell that has been ready to go for a while, but medical community and playing gone,
mm-hmm.
keeping it alive when it's all said and done?
Well, unless it's kind of interesting because it did have a DNR, but unless his heart stopped, they were going to do everything else.
Yeah.
So.
I know. It's like, yeah, there's always more.
But
thank you.
It should be interesting to see where that goes, and I'm hoping that it will, because I think if people do have more choice and more control, that it'll take away some of those fears.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And you know, maybe the thing too is that it would force people to have those discussions, because it has to be on paper. There has to, and like as I said to my mom, you should be discussing now with your doctor.
Mm-hmm.
What, because you've seen what can happen firsthand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So now's your time to get things on paper with your own family physician and let them know your wishes. And let us know, of course, as well.
Exactly.
But don't wait.
Don't wait till you can't make the decision.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do it now while you can.
So I'm kind of hoping that it will improve people's outlook about death.
That's what I'm kind of hoping. I think that's why I wanted to start this conversation.
Mm.
Not because there's a right answer or a wrong answer. There isn't.
No.
But it's, let's just have a conversation. It's inevitable.
It is. The end will come.
It
death
will.
And taxes.
Death and taxes. The two things in town. Constant change.
Said, don't you